all our participants, all the colleagues, and all the chief guests over here. Thank you each and every participants for registering for this 1 week virtual faculty development program. A very good afternoon to one and all. I am Dr. Sumit Hangargi, Associate Professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. It's my privilege to host the event. A warm welcome here for the inauguration of this 1 week virtual national level faculty development program on emerging trends in mechanical energy engineering in collaboration with Mech and Professional Educational Society, which is being scheduled from 22nd April 2024 to 27th April 2024. This program is being organized by Mechanical Engineering Department of LIET Institute of Engineering and Technology. The world is full of diamonds, iron gems, and we are here having some of them here today to build this event. With this note, I would like to give my heartiest welcome to chief guests, Mr. R. Suman, Head of the Department of Mechanical Engineering. I request Suman sir to please keep a seat on dais. Welcome, sir. Next, I request Sayyad Nawazis Mehdi, sir, to occupy the dais. I request Sayyad Nawazis Mehdi, sir, to occupy the seat on the dais. I request everybody to please welcome them. I request the Dean IQC, Dr. Santan Kumar, sir, to sit on the dais. I request everybody to please welcome them with claps. Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Sayyed Azam Pasha Khadri, sir, the Vice Principal of LIET. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. J. Shashikiran, sir, Dean Planning and Coordination, LIET, to occupy the seat on the dais. Thank you for joining the program, sir. Now I request Dr. K. Nagi Reddy, Dean Academics of Institute of Engineering Technology, to please occupy a seat on the dais. Now I request Dr. Sheikh Shavali, sir, to occupy the seat on the dais. I request everybody to please welcome our guest by your claps. Now I request Dr. Ravi Kishore Singh, sir, the principal of Institute of Engineering Technology, to occupy the seat on the dais. Thank you, sir. Now I request our associate head, Mr. Samantha Madhukar. Thank you all. Welcome is to establish the integrity. I request Mr. Samantha Madhukar, sir, associate head, Department of Mechanical Engineering, Labs, to deliver the welcome and also highlight the object of organizing the faculty development program. Sir.
Warm greetings for the day. Respected dignitaries on the dais, Dr. R. K. Singh, Principal, Dr. Sayad Adam Pasha, sir, Vice Principal, Dr. Shashi Kiran, Dean Evaluation and Dean Planning and Coordination, Dr. Nawaish Maidi, sir, Dean FTD, respected Dr. Santan, sir, Dean IQAC, and Mr. R. Suman, sir, HOD. Warm greetings. I, Mr. Madhukar Samatham, Organizing Chair and Associate Head of Mechanical Engineering Department, welcome you all to the 1 week virtual national level faculty development program on emerging trends in mechanical engineering conducted in collaboration with IMECI and Professional Education Services. Firstly, I would like to thank the experts for taking their precious time out and making to this event. Secondly, I would want to thank my audience for being present here today. Before we begin with our today's session, please allow me to deliver a short speech in order to warm up you everyone about the upcoming FDP. LIET strongly believes that human resource is an important element which is needed to realize the institute's goals and aspirations. Hence, LIET Institute of Engineering and Technology is trying to maintain high-skilled and efficient academic faculty in order to achieve excellent standards in all the disciplines offered by Institute. On behalf of Mechanical Engineering Department, I am honored to welcome all the participants who have gathered here both virtually and physically today for this FDP. It is truly a privilege to have the opportunity to learn from such experienced and knowledgeable resource persons. As a faculty, we constantly seek ways to expand our knowledge and improve our understanding of various fields and learn about new and existing research. To the faculty and industry experts here today, I want to remind you to make the most of this opportunity. A special welcome is also extended to the resource persons joining today. We appreciate your willingness to share your knowledge and expertise. I am confident that everyone here will gain something from your lectures and truly helpful to our team. In conclusion, this will be a valuable and informative experience for all of us. So let's make the most of this opportunity and take away something new and existing to share with our peers. So let's begin this journey of learning and discovery together. Thank you all for being here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for throwing the enlightenment on the FDP by your welcome address. Now I request the head of the Department of Mechanical Engineering, Mr. R. Suman, sir, to address the gathering.
Very good afternoon. Respected Principal Dr. R. K. Singaru, Vice Principal Dr. Sayed Ajam Pasha Khadri, sir, Dean First Year Dr. Shashi Kiran, sir, Dean IQAC Dr. Santan, sir, Dean Academics and Head of the Department of IT Dr. Nagireddy, sir, Head of the Department of CSE Dr. Sheikh Shavali, sir, Senior Professor Department of Mechanical Engineering, Dr. Nawazis Mehdi sir, my colleagues, and especially the participants for this 1 week which was national level faculty development program on emerging trends in mechanical engineering. A warm welcome to each and everyone for this great FDP. So let me introduce the resource persons for this 6 days. And one thing I need to add before letting know about the resource persons, after a requesting through phone call, the all resource person, they came forward, instantly they accepted. So behalf of entire mechanical department and Lords Institute of Engineering and Technology, very thank you each and every resource persons, and especially this faculty development program we are conducting in collaboration with IMECI, which is the student chapter, and professional educational services. And here the today the resource person, Professor M. Chandra Sekhar Reddy garu, he is the professor and head of the Department of Mechanical Engineering, Usmania University. And tomorrow, that is on 23rd, Mr. Mahesh Shinde. On 24th, we have Dr. Nagaraj RG. He is associate professor and dean, student affairs, mechanical department. Guru Nanak Dev Engineering College from Karnataka. On 25th, we have Dr. Ashwin Kumar. He is the R&D engineer. And 26th, we have Dr. Shan. He is the vice principal and the dean academics, Department of Mechanical Engineering from Kerala. And same day on 26th, we have a great resource person, Dr. Hardenaya Garu. He is the professor of Mechanical Engineering Department, Usmania University. Dr. Raguyal, he is the cooperative head and director. On Saturday, we have these sessions. So these are the resource persons for all these 6 days for 1 week faculty development program. And here we have a great number of participants. So looking forward, requesting all the participants, make a note, the attendance is mandatory for entire week. Questionnaires will be there. And requesting all the teaching staff of Department of Mechanical Engineering, make it a grand success, faculty development program. And thank you each and every one of you for accepting our invitation and gathering here, supporting us, encouraging us, and especially our management. Even at this particular time, we are very fully occupied with academics, but our curriculum may be, you know, having a boundaries, but for teachers, we do not have any boundaries. We are always learners, and we hope this FDP will help each and every participants and the Department of Mechanical Engineering faculties also. With this, I thank each and every one of you, and I request each and every participant to attend every day and to share your thoughts also during these sessions. And especially on Saturday, we will be having panel discussion with the idea of our principal sir and our management. So this Saturday we will be having a panel discussion, and different resource persons will be attending for the panel discussion. So with this, thank you each and every one of you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable words. And for sure, this will be a grand success under you, with all the support of all the chief guests and our participants and our colleagues from the department. Next, I would like to call up Dr. K. Nagi Reddy, sir, Dean Academics of LIET, Institute of Engineering and Technology, to address the gathering.
Respected Principal Dr. R. K. Singh, sir. Respected Vice Principal Dr. Rajam Kashavadri, sir. Other deans and as convener for the program and head of mechanical department, Mr. R. Suman, mechanical faculty and the participants. Good afternoon, one and all. So I know mechanical department since last 10 years. Even though I joined here 6 years back, I know about mechanical department since last 10 years. So one of my ex-colleague, Mr. Satish, used to say about mechanical department and Ajam sir, about the events. Even after joining here also, I observed the way the mechanical department conducts Tech Fest under Megaska and the recent programs conducted on 3D printing and all these things. Mechanical department faces, or mechanical engineering faces, so many challenges today, such as designing systems and components for our future sustainability and energy efficiency. Artificial intelligence has attracted interest in recent years due to AI technological advancements and increasing ability to process large amounts of data. AI can be applied in the designs, automated guided vehicles, industrial robots, and many more. AI and ML provides the viable solutions for turbo machinery, heat exchangers with different topologies, 3D printing, eco-friendly materials, and manufacturing processes to minimize environment impact for all this. The field of mechanical engineering is flourishing with innovation and opportunity. Whether it is pushing the boundaries of 3D printing, pioneer sustainable energy solutions, or automation, mechanical engineers continue to drive progress and shape the world of tomorrow. Good wishes to all of you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your words towards our department and towards the faculty development program that we are conducting. Now I request Dean IQC Dr. Santun Kumar, sir, to give his enlightenment.
Very good afternoon. And as mentioned by our Dean Academics, mechanical department is fond of conducting these kind of events for many years. With the experience they had and having many senior faculty in the department, they maintain that from starting of event to the end of the event, to the utmost satisfaction of the participants. And I congratulate the entire department, especially convener Mr. Suman and the co-convener Mr. Madhukar, for bringing up this 1 week virtual FDP on emerging trends in mechanical engineering, making it available across the country. And it is fortunate to know that more than nearly 200 students, 200 faculty are participating in this FDP. I hope and I am sure that all these participants will have a lot of takeaways from this FDP for the next 1 week. And I wish each and everyone a happy learning. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Student Dr. Shavali Singh to express his gratitude.
Dignitaries on the dais, Principal Dr. R.K. Singh sir, Vice Principal Dr. Syed Asham Pasha Khadri sir, Deans, Convener Mr. Suman, Co-Convener Madhukar, all the staff of the Mechanical Department gathered here for this FDP on Emerging Trends in Mechanical Engineering. Good afternoon to you all. It gives me immense pleasure that the Mechanical Department is conducting and exposing and giving a lift for the fraternity of the Mechanical Department of the Engineering Colleges on Pan India to expose the trends that are going on in the market, the technologies that are emerging in the market in the field of mechanical engineering. You know pretty well that our college is equipped with 3D printing lab. It's a momentous and I can say, as far as the technology advancement for the students and faculty goes, definitely it's a feather in the cap of Mechanical Department that recently also they conducted workshop in 3D printing technology, how the powder based structures can be printed in the 3D form. Really, even I being on the computer and being the head of the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, I had a chance, I went there, really it was very good, because it's important that, as other deans were telling, that AI has come into our lives, artificial intelligence has come into our lives, where it is making us to run with it. Though artificial, we all have natural intelligence, but still to survive, to make our lives to move, to go ahead, to be in pace with the technology and the market and the industries required, that AI has come in almost all domains, where also AI are also intercepted and it has been incorporated even in the Mechanical Engineering Department. You know that 3D printing is one, 3D printing is one. We also have this smart kind of, you know, technology where we have this IoT, we have AI and robotics. Really, it is doing wonderful kind of advancements as far as the mechanical engineering goes, mechanical department movement goes. We also have things coming up, I don't know, most probably 24, 25. North Korea and China are going to go for mass production of humanoids, not robots. Humanoids are those which look like humans, act like humans, move like humans. So what not, the technology is coming. Only it is because the mechanical engineering, you know, which is playing a major vital role as far as the robotics are concerned, where AI has been incorporated. So I hope this, there are a lot of things to discuss, but I think I'm not a better person as far as the mechanical engineering goes. I've seen there are very good speakers, and for this 7 days long sessions, I request all of you to fully utilize this, and I see that you give the same content to the students and have a better know-how of the technology. Thank you.
Now I request Dr. J. Shashikiran sir, Dean Planning and Evaluation, to please speak few words on this occasion.
Respected Principal Sir, Vice Principal Sir, Deans, HODs, my dear colleague friends, and all faculty members registered for this 1 week FDP on Emerging Trends in Mechanical Engineering. At outset, I'd like to extend my congratulations to the Department of Mechanical Engineering for conducting every semester one or two FDPs to give more enhance towards the emerging areas in mechanical engineering. Congratulations, Head of the Department Suman Sir and Vice Principal Ajam Sir. I'd like to inform everyone who is participating in this 1 week FDP. Our college is established in 2002. From that day onwards till today, we are conducting such type of events every semester and every weekly once student development program, every semester one or twice FDPs we are organizing. Anyway, congratulations to all the registered candidates. Please extend your kind cooperation, participate all the sessions so that you can learn so many things, so many emerging areas from this wonderful faculty development program arranged for the all staff members. I am extending my heart welcome to our Honorable Secretary Madam, Mrs. Rizwana Begum Madam. Thank you, Madam, for gracing the occasion. I request HOD Suman Sir to give a token of thanks to a small plant to the Madam for honoring. Madam is always giving and encouraging the faculties and staff members to conduct such type of events always in the college. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable words. A heartiest warm welcome to our Secretary of Engineering Technology, Ms. Rizwana Begum. Welcome, Madam. Welcome for the 1 week virtual national level faculty development program on emerging trends in mechanical engineering. We welcome you all. Now I request Vice Principal Dr. Sekhar to speak to us on this occasion.
Good afternoon to one and all. Respected dignitaries on the dais of the dais, especially Secretary Madam, Principal Sir, Dean, heads of the department, and all the FDP participants. Once again, I warmly welcome all you on this FDP. Before sharing my words, first of all, I want to congratulate the entire team of mechanical engineering headed by Suman and associate head Madhukar and his team. Once again, congratulate. Within a short time, they have did a wonderful job by inviting good speakers. Within no time, they have organized a well-organized way this FDP. Once again, congratulate. Actually, the motto or the object behind this FDP to provide a platform where faculties can learn, where faculties can update their knowledge, where faculties can enhance their skills by doing research and latest trends, by coming these eminent personalities where their rich experience and they will share their knowledge with the faculty, so that whatever the problems or doubt or whatever the emerging trends in the mechanical engineering, where we can able to learn and exchange their opinions, and when the faculties can update by using of this particular FDP. FDPs are essential because of globalization. What are the latest trends? We have to learn. Now, every day the innovations are taking place. Technology is changing. Technology is upgrading. And being a faculty, it's our prime duty to update ourselves. So this platform provides all these things. So I request all the participants, and once again I will congratulate the mechanical team. Within a short period, more than 180 students have faculties, more than 180 faculties have registered. This is a good sign, and which shows that this is a huge successful of the FDP. But my request, whatever the sessions are there, make use of that particular sessions. You have to enhance your skills. This is the time where you can exchange. If any queries, please note down, and there is a question section, question and answer session is there. You can exchange your questions so that it can be addressed, and you can able to upgrade which by yourself you can enhance your academic performances. You can deliver knowledge to the students by this FDP. The proportionality, you learn more, you can deliver more. You have the research ideas that can be transferred to the students. So FDPs are essential, as we are the 3 times NAC accredited, and every time we used to have this FDP, this is the first time so many participants are registered. So once again, congratulate the entire team of mechanical engineering for successfully conducting of this FDP. Thank you. Thank a lot.
Thank you very much, sir. Your words are really true, that each and every individual faculty has to upgrade themselves in the life. Then only they'll reach to somewhere and they can teach something new and enhance something new to the students. That's really a wonderful talk, sir. Thank you for your talk. Now I request principals, please address that on stock. Sir.
Good afternoon, everybody. Rizwana Madam, our Honorable Secretary Madam, my dear colleagues. I was just going through which is the oldest branch of engineering in the history of world. So there were two branches which I zeroed on to. First was civil, and second was mechanical. And somebody told me civil came into existence moment people started making houses. But before people started making houses, fire and wheels were in place. And that's what makes mechanical one of the oldest branches of civil engineering, one of the oldest branches of engineering, which is there with us. It gives me immense pleasure to tell you that we have been conducting a lot number of FDPs. Just now, IT has finished one. We have more than 200 faculty members that registered. There's the second one in the line by mechanical, emerging trends, which means it's going to take you to the new generation, new technologies. And that is what is the need of mechanical engineering today. What we can add to the mechanical so that it becomes one of the sought after branch by the students. We have one also in ECE lined up with NIT. We have two FDPs lined up under Project Vani. We have applied for it. So it's been our tradition to educate the faculty in all disciplines of engineering. And I'm very proud, very satisfied that mechanical has been able to do it in a very short time. The number of the speakers are eminent. They are absolutely authorities in their respective fields. I hope there'll be a lot more to learn by you. And I welcome all of you. Thank you so much for joining us. And it'll be a great pleasure delivering the sessions. It'll be great pleasure for you to learn. And of course, what like Pasha sir said, our vice principal sir, please be interactive. You have any simple, stupid doubt, you bring it out, clarify it. And let me tell you, most of the stupid doubts turn into innovations. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your words. Obviously, the mechanical engineering is one of the oldest branch that everybody knows about it, that even we have kept this emerging technologies that we can transform the industries and society by introducing more efficient process and products. We have also seen the recent examples, sir, including artificial intelligence, flexible batteries, and sustainable fuel are revolutionizing our world. Have humans generate ideas, power, devices, and travel. Thank you for your valuable words. Now I request I request Honorable Secretary on virtual National Faculty in the Mechanical Engineering Department.
Good afternoon, all of you. Our college faculties, hen heads, and principal, and other people, university people, and other college faculties, congratulations. Every year program, this is program we are conducting every year. FDP program, international program, this is development. Faculty develop how to teach, how to knowledge develop. And nowadays, mechanical department is very low admissions in future, mechanical department is very development department, always green. Mechanical is always green, inshallah. Everyone, be serious. Whatever you learn, please take seriousness and note down and inform teaching to the students and projects everywhere you can get this knowledge, this program. University people are online there, and other colleges, universities people are online. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you again the of time to the Lords. Thank you for everyone. All the best, all of you. Be serious. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, each and everybody. Thank you, madam. Thank you for your valuable words. Now I request our civil HOD to speak few words on this occasion. Okay, thank you, sir. Now, thank you all the chief guests.
You get the list of speakers and the list of session is shared with you. Please go through it once and make down your plan how you will sit down with the present committee and listen to all of them. The topics are very interesting. The speakers are very eminent. So make the best use of it. Thank you so much, Suman. Thank you so much, the mechanical team. And I thank all of you for organizing such a wonderful event. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Asif Kattimani to give us thanks for this inauguration program.
Good afternoon, everyone. Respected Secretary Madam, Principal Sir, Vice Principal Sir, Deans, esteemed speakers, participants and distinguished guests, it is with immense pleasure and gratitude that I extend my heartfelt thanks to all of you for gracing inaugural function of our 1 week faculty virtual national level faculty development program on emerging trend in mechanical engineering. First and foremost, I would like to express our deepest appreciation to our Chairman Sir, Secretary Madam, Vice Chairman Sir and Joint Secretary Sir for their visionary leadership and unwavering support in bringing this FDP to fulfillment. Your encouragement and patronage have been instrumental in empowering us to organize this enriching event. A special thanks goes to our Principal Sir and Vice Principal Sir for involvement and invaluable guidance throughout the planning and execution of this FDP. Your commitment to academic excellence has been truly inspiring. I extend my sincere gratitude to our Deans, first year, Dean Student Affairs, Dean Accuracy, Dean Academics and Head of the Department for their continuous encouragement and support. Your presence today has added immense value to the inaugural function and set a positive tune for the entire FDP. I would also like to extend warm thanks to you to our esteemed speaker who has graciously agreed to share their expertise and insight with us during this FDP. Your participation has elevated the quality of our program and promises a week filled with the learning and inspiration. Lastly, I would like to acknowledge and thank the organizing committee, faculty members, staff, volunteer, and technical support team for their tireless efforts in planning and coordinating with the virtual events seamlessly. As we embark on this week-long journey for exploration and learning, let us carry forward the spirit of collaboration and innovation to advance the field of mechanical engineering. Once again, a sincere thank you to everyone present here today. We look forward to a week of insightful session and meaningful interaction. Thank you. Thank you for all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your word of thanks. I thank all the chief guests over here present. Our resource person is here in the, in the task of introducing our resource person is a great privilege. We are really honored that he find a way to be with us today, despite of his busy schedule. That's so generous of him. It also conveys how compassionate he is towards the faculty development program. He is none other than Dr. M. Chandrasekhar Reddy, sir, professor and head of the Department of Mechanical Engineering at the University College of Engineering, Usmania University, Hyderabad. He is B.Tech, M.Tech and Ph.D. He is also chairman of Board of Studies at University Department of Mechanical Engineering. We come from Sri Venkateshwar University. He comes from Mysore University. Mysore, and he completed his Chennai. His research is condition multiple finite element techniques. If you talk about objects, Sir Sekhar All India 1994, which was conducted by IIT Kharagpur. He also visited the United States of America and presented research papers, metals and material society in 2007, Orlando, Florida, USA. He has published papers, articles in various international and conferences. He has guided 116 BE and ME projects, guided by many PhD scholars too. He also acts as a selection committee member, IICT as subject expert, and is also a FFC member at GMSH. We welcome you, sir, for this social virtual national technical development. We welcome you, and I request you to please proceed to further things.
Sir.
Yeah,
sir. Good afternoon, sir. Sir, we will begin in another 2 minutes, sir. Anchor will start.
Hello. Good afternoon, all. I will come back to the session. Well, the resource person, sir, has already joined the session. Today, the task of introducing our resource person is a great privilege. We are really honored that he find a way to be with us today. Despite of his busy schedule, that's so generous of him, and it also conveys how compassionate he is towards the faculty development program. He is none other than Dr. M. Chandrasekhar Reddy, sir, professor and head of the Department of Mechanical Engineering at University College of Engineering, Usmania University, Hyderabad. He is BTech, MTech, and PhD. He is also a chairman, board of studies at the University College of Engineering, Department of ME. He completed his BTech in Mechanical Engineering from Sri Venkateshwara University, Tirupati. He also completed his MTech from Mysore University, Mysore. And he completed his PhD in 2015 from IIT Madras, Chennai. His research interests are in vibrations, condition monitoring, finite element techniques. If you talk about the awards, sir has secured All India Rank 271 in GATE 1994, which was conducted by IIT Kharagpur. He also visited United States of America and presented a research paper in Minerals, Metals and Material Society in 2007, Orlando, Florida, USA. He has total 36 published papers and articles in various international and national reputed journal and conferences. He has guided 116 BE and ME projects and also guided many PhD scholars. He also acts as a selection committee member, IICT, as subject expert, and he is also a FFC member at JN2H. Hello, sir. I welcome you for the 1 week virtual national level faculty development program. The session is all yours, sir. I request you to please continue the session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
You're welcome, sir.
Nice introduction.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon, all the participants. So, shall I share my presentation? Sumit.
Hello. Sir, I can share your screen, sir. Please share your screen. Sir, I request you to share your screen.
Sharing my presentation, there is some problem with this.
Okay, sir, no problem.
Just 1 minute. Give me a time, 1 minute.
Sure, sir, all time is yours. Can take a time, no problem.
Hello, sir.
Is it visible, Mr. Suma?
Sir, not yet, sir. Not yet, sir.
It is telling stop screen sharing. It is already shared. I don't know.
1 second, sir. We are into it.
It is showing stop screen sharing or resume presenting.
Okay, sir. We are into it. Just give us a second. Okay.
Yeah, good afternoon, my dear participants. So before starting the topic, am I audible?
Yes, sir, audible.
Yeah, before starting my presentation, I take this opportunity to thank and congratulate the management of LIET Institute for organizing such a wonderful program and keep the department vibrant. I also thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity, especially Professor Syed Ajam Pasha Kadri, sir, and Syed Nawazish Mehdi, sir, Mr. R. Suman, Mr. Mohammed Asif, Dr. Mohammed Asif, Mr. Madhukar, S. Madhukar, Mr. Sai Suman, and other organizing team. So now I'm going to present about vibrations and condition monitoring. So I always prefer an interactive session. So whenever you have any clarification or anything required, immediately you can interrupt me. I don't mind. So this, next slide. So this is the outline, vibrations. I'll touch upon some of the vibration aspects, condition monitoring, spectrums, how the different spectrums will be there, used in condition monitoring, mathematical aspects, 2D degrees of freedom systems, multi degrees of freedom systems, and some aspects on the artificial intelligence. Yeah, next. So what is vibration? We know vibration is a back and forth movement of a structure. It can also be referred to as a cyclical movement. A body is said to vibrate if it has to and fro motion also. Back and forth, to and fro, both are same. So then we say the structure is vibrating. So here, people say machines talk through vibrations. That means if you are able to interpret the vibrations of a particular machine, you can exactly pinpoint what exactly is wrong with the machine, especially mechanical faults. We can exactly able to tell by studying the vibrations, by interpreting the vibration patterns properly, you can do that. Yeah, next. So any motion that repeats itself after an interval of time is called vibration. Another definition, of course, it is both, it is same. So the swinging pendulum, swinging of a pendulum and the motion of a plucked string and typical typical examples of vibration. So the theory of vibration deals with the study of oscillatory motions of bodies and the forces associated with them. So whenever we talk about vibrations, the first thing is natural frequency. So natural frequency is frequency of free undamped vibrations is called natural frequency of the system. Here the word free in the sense there is no forcing function and there is no damping in the system, undamped. Then frequency of that particular vibrations is called the natural frequency of the system. So here we need to talk about degrees of freedom. So the degrees of freedom is number of independent coordinates required to describe the system completely is called degrees of freedom. So here generally in vibrations we have single degree of freedom systems, 2 degree of freedom systems and multi degrees of freedom systems. Yeah, next. So here we discuss about some maintenance aspects because condition monitoring is one of the maintenance technique. So different maintenance methods practiced in the industry are, you know, there are 4 different methods are there. Breakdown maintenance. So this particular breakdown maintenance is used or initiated whenever the machine fails. Until the machine fails, we don't bother about the maintenance aspects. Once the machine is breakdown, so then we initiate some maintenance activity. So this kind of maintenance method can be used for not that much important equipment or machines. Then comes preventive maintenance or it's also called fixed time replacement. So this is a little bit advanced than the breakdown maintenance. Here we can schedule our maintenance activities in this preventive maintenance method or fixed time replacement. That means, as an example, if you take a bearing, ball bearing in a particular equipment, so the manufacturer will specify the life of the bearing. Let us say 1 million cycles is the life of the bearing. So we calculate the time period, in how much time the bearing is going to run for 1 million cycles. So based on the operating time every day, every week, and based on those factors, we'll come to a conclusion. So let us say in 6 months, the bearing is going to complete 1 million cycles. It depends on the machine, of course, as an example, I'm telling. So every 6 months, we replace the bearing. Whether the bearing fails or not, we don't bother about that. Every 6 months, we replace the bearing. So this is called preventive maintenance. So then comes predictive maintenance. So this predictive maintenance is also called condition monitoring. So in this, what we can do is, as in the previous example, after 6 months, we replace the bearing, whether the bearing fails or not, even it has some remaining life is there. It can be used for some more time. But even then we are replacing it at every 6 months. But here in this predictive maintenance, we can predict the health of the bearing. If some health is there, if it is in good condition, it can be allowed for another month. So here that is possible in this predictive maintenance method. We can predict this. How the prediction is done is, so here to do this or to do the condition monitoring, there are different condition monitoring methods out there. Like one is condition monitoring through vibrations, and condition monitoring through acoustics. So, and other thing is VRW analysis. So acoustic emission monitoring, we discuss my emphasis on condition monitoring through vibrations. So other things, this we'll talk later. Before that, condition monitoring through acoustic seams. By using microphones, we measure the vibration sound levels and we'll get the frequency components. We'll do some conclusions. Of course, that's not my area, I'm not working, but different methods. So other thing is VRW analysis. In VRW analysis, what people do is, so they collect the sample oil from the lube oil sump. So in that, they analyze for the elements which are present in that particular sample oil, like whether it is cast iron particles or aluminium particles or some other things, stainless steel particles like that. So different elements will be able to tell what are present in the sample oil, and also shape and size. Depending on the shape and size, whether the machine is in good condition or some maintenance activity is required, all those things can be done this way with this analysis. So these are the things, some of the things we can do. So apart from this, we have NDT. The difference between NDT and this condition monitoring is NDT is an offline technique. For doing NDT, we have to stop the machine, or generally for the in the production unit for new component, they do some NDT and they check the any defects are there or not, they are going to do that. So it's an offline technique. We have to stop the machine, we have to remove the component, and we have to check it. So this condition monitoring is not NDT, it is online technique. We need not stop the machine. We just collect some vibration data, coming to the vibration first thing. So we collect some vibration data, we analyze that particular data, and we'll be able to make some conclusions. And based on that, we'll be able to schedule our maintenance activities. Then comes the proactive or corrective maintenance. So this is useful in unmanned factories. So it is there in some developed countries, but I don't know whether India, any industry is practicing that or not. I have no idea. So this is proactive maintenance. So my emphasis on this predictive maintenance, that is condition monitoring through vibrations. Next. So this condition monitoring is very much useful in continuous process industries where production cost is in crores, is very high compared to the maintenance cost. Maintenance cost may be few thousands. But what happens if you take a bulk drag industry? So the process, it takes 48 hours to generally this to produce the bulk drag. So the process, it takes nearly 48 hours to 72 hours. So in between, in the line, any machine fails, entire process comes to halt. The process will be stopped. So this, if it is process is stopped, the way the loss will be in crores. The entire process, again, they have to begin. So, and all the chemicals, what they have used, all those things will be waste. So this process cost or production cost is very high in this continuous process industries. It will be in terms of crores. Okay. Whereas the maintenance cost is very less, it's few thousands only. So in this case, this is in this particular continuous process industries, this predictive maintenance is very much helpful. Of course, for this, using condition monitoring, we need a lot of initial cost, initial investment. So a lot of sophisticated instruments are required. So by using those instruments, we'll be able to do the condition monitoring by using vibration analysis. And other factors where it is most useful and cost effective is, as I told you, the initial investment will be very high. So the other important industry is petrochemical industry, where safety is very important. So in first case, it is process industry, it is production cost, process cost is very high. So here petrochemical industry, it is safety is very important. Any catastrophic failure may lead to a lot of safety aspects. Sometimes it may cause some casualties. So there, in these two industries, this condition monitoring is very much useful and justifiable. It is feasible also, cost effective. Okay, next. So here, so unbalance is a very big problem in rotating machinery. So when we know the unbalanced force, mu omega square, or sometimes it is mr omega square, it is a centrifugal force. So here, see, unbalanced force is the mass. If some unbalance is there in the machine, especially in rotating machinery, so if some unbalance is there, it is detrimental to the machine or sometimes to the process. Okay. So here, the mass amount of balancing mass, how much we have to add, that depends on, for example, in sugar industries, we have fibrizers and cane cutters like machines, which runs at 50 to 60 RPM. So very slow speed machines, very low running machines, long running speed machines. and some machines in paper industry also runs at very low speeds. In these machines, balancing mass added will be in the order of kilograms. If it is running at 50 RPM, so it is very slow speed machine. So the balancing, the mass we have to add is sometimes it will be in kgs, half kg, 1 kg, 2 kg sometimes. So whereas some machines like instrument air compressor, as an example, runs at 60,000 RPM compared to that low speed machine 60 RPM and 60,000 RPM, 1,000 times more. So here 60,000 RPM means it comes to 1,000 Hz. If you convert it to radians per second, it will be 6,280 radians per second, very high running speeds. So here we know this unbalanced force is Me omega square. If omega is 50 or 60, so the unbalanced force is very less, the mass to be added is very less, very high, mass to be added is very high. It's previously. Okay, whereas this instrument air compressor like machines, so the running speed is very high. So omega, if you substitute this very high speeds, it will omega square is there. So the unbalanced force is very, very high. So here the mass we need to add is even 1 gram is a, it creates a lot of unbalanced force. So here in the mass added will be in grams, maybe 1 or 2 grams. Okay. So that why I am emphasizing is you should know the difference. So sometimes unbalanced mass will be in kgs, and some machines it will be in grams. Even 1 gram it matters a lot in case of this instrument air compressor like machines. Yes, next please. So what is vibration caused by? What are the causes of vibrations? So the causes of vibrations are imperfections in the machines. So that imperfections can be at any stage. Maybe design stage, some imperfections will be there. If the designer not designed the machine properly, that leads to vibration. So assembly stage and manufacturing stage. While manufacturing, if there are some defects out there, it lead to vibrations. Operation, during operation, if any mistakes are there, that leads to vibration. Installation and maintenance, all these stages, these imperfections cause the vibrations. What are some common machine problems that generate mechanical vibrations? So these are some of the common machine problems. Those are misalignment, worn belts and pulleys, hydraulic forces, reaction forces, bent shafts, and gear problems, certain electrical problems, and unbalance, as we just discussed. Unbalance is one very, very important thing. We need to be very attentive, especially in rotating machines. Bearing defects, aerodynamic forces, reciprocating forces, rubbing, housing distortion, and frictional forces. So these are some of the common machine problems that lead to the vibration. Here, one important thing we need to know, we need to give attention. So what are some common machine problems that amplify mechanical problems but don't cause it? That means resonance and looseness, they're not the causes of vibration. But if at all, if any vibrations, small vibrations are there, this resonance will amplify the vibrations. Looseness also will amplify the vibration. This is a small difference one should know. So resonance and looseness are not the causes of vibration, but if at all, if some small vibration is there, these resonance and looseness will amplify the vibration. Yes, next. So to capture the vibration data, the following instruments are generally used. We use vibrometers, data collectors, and vibration analyzers. So vibrometers are cost-wise, it costs very less. Data collectors, little more than the vibrometers, and vibration analyzers will cost very high. So vibrometer, what is the difference? Vibrometer or data collector or vibration analyzer? Vibrometer, it just gives the vibration levels, overall vibration levels. Okay?
So that overall vibration levels is, in technically it is called filter out vibration. And filtering vibration is frequency or spectral components. So this is given by the vibration analyzers. So we'll discuss vibrometers. If you talk about vibrometers, it gives the overall vibrations levels. So how it is useful for the industry? For example, if generally all the machines are classified into some four classes, there are some standards are there, IS 2372 standards are there for this vibration, measure vibration levels in condition monitoring. Of course, the number, it is changed recent times, it is changed to some other number. Earlier it was IS 2372, don't worry, equivalent number now you can get on internet. So according to IS 2372, what they have done is, all the machines are classified into four classes. So for each class, they have specified certain vibration limits. So that depends on the wattage of the machine, that means power of the machine, or the mounting procedure, mounting method, and like that, so many factors are there. Based on those factors, all the general purpose mechanical machines are classified into four classes. For each class, they have specified certain vibration limits. For example, class one machine can vibrate up to some 6.5 millimeters per second. If it is more than that, we need to pay some attention and we need to do some maintenance. So like that, every 15 days, depending on the criticality of the machine, if it is very critical or not that much critical, or it's not at all important, depending on the criticality of the machine, we measure vibration levels at regular intervals. Maybe that depends on that by experience and depending on the technician and the engineer associated with it, they specify the time period. Sometimes for some machines, it may be 15 days. Sometimes for some machines, it will be at every 1 month, we collect the vibration levels. And we compare this vibration levels, overall vibration level, with the specified vibration limits. If it is well below the vibration limits, then we don't bother about that. So over a period of time, while the machines are running, after some time, it crosses the limit. If the, as I told you, for a particular class of a machine, if the vibration limits are set as 6.5 millimeters per second, if it is more than that, when you measure it after a certain period, if the vibration levels goes beyond 6.5, that is 7 millimeters second, for example, then in that case, we immediately came to know, so there is something wrong in the machine. What is wrong, we don't know by using these vibrometers. But we will immediately came to know that there is something wrong in the machine. That is, with that, we'll stop the machine. We do the thorough analysis, and depending on that, we schedule some maintenance activities. I mean, we do the corrections, repair. Then comes data collectors. Data collectors, what it will do is, you can collect data from various machines. Then by that data collect, whatever data is there, that you connect to the computer, there will be certain softwares are there, Davisoft-like softwares are there. So there we do the analysis. Data collect is a medium one. So it collects the data, but we cannot able to do any analysis in that by that data collector. We need to connect to the computer. We need to have some software. So in the computer, we'll analyze and we'll come to know what is done. Whereas when it comes to vibration analyzers, so these analyzers are having inbuilt computer-like thing, inbuilt advanced processes will be there. The cost-wise, it is very costly. So the analyzers, what it will do when you collect the vibration data, so it will give the, it will do the transformation, Fourier transform or whatever it is, it do the it does the transformation, and will be able to tell what is wrong in the machine. Okay? Exactly, we can pinpoint where is whether it is, there is some unbalance is there, or looseness is there, some misalignment, or bent shaft, or sometimes problem in the gears, or sometimes bearings. All those things we'll be able to tell by studying this, by using this vibration analysis. Okay? This filter out and filter in, as I told you, filter out means overall vibration level. This particular filter out reading is given by the vibrometers. Vibrometer will not give filter in reading. It will not give frequency information or frequency components or spectral components. It will not give. Whereas vibration analyzer will give the spectral components. And if it is data collector, we need to connect to the system. And system in system will be able to get the spectral components. So next, please. How data is displayed? Generally, the time domain plot displays amplitude versus time. This time domain plot, amplitude versus time. Y-axis it is amplitude and x-axis it is time. So these things, general sum description. And next. Yeah, typically a time domain plot will be like this. Y-axis it is amplitude, x-axis it is time. Whether it is seconds or milliseconds, depending on the sampling frequency, it is x-axis, seconds or milliseconds. So the time domain plot is a powerful tool to use for analysis since it is as close to the raw data. So this time domain data is called raw data. Generally, most of the times from raw data will not be in a position to make any comment. It gives no information. So, but whereas vibrometer, when you use, it will give overall amplitude, vibration levels. But apart from the no information, nothing we can conclude from this time domain plot. But what to do then? Whenever you measure physically, we'll get the time domain data only. Yeah, next please. So this is FFT data, or we can say spectrum. Or we can also call this particular plot is a also called as vibration signature. Y-axis it is amplitude. What is the amplitude? Maybe amplitude may be measured in displacement, velocity, or acceleration. And x-axis frequency. How we'll get this particular data? So we don't get this data when we measure from the machines by using any of the transducers. We'll get time domain data only. We need to do the Fourier transform of that particular time domain data to get the spectral components or frequency components, frequency data. So here, y-axis amplitude and x-axis frequency. At what frequency, what is the amplitude of vibration? Based on that, we'll be able to make some conclusions. A spectrum is plot of amplitude versus frequency. The above plot is a spectrum that was created from a time domain plot using a mathematical principle called the fast Fourier transform or FFT. This plot is often simply referred to as an FFT plot. Fast Fourier transform, if just it is Fourier transform, it converts the time domain data to the frequency domain data, or frequency domain plot. But it is very laborious when you want to do a paper or physically want to do, it is very laborious. So this to make it fast, they made it FFT algorithms are available now, fast Fourier transform. Quickly, it gives time domain data to the frequency domain data. Next, please. So this transformation, just we have a quick look into this. X of t is a signal. So capital X of small x of t is a signal. Capital X of omega is a frequency domain plot. We have a time domain signal. We need to transform it to the frequency domain plot. For that, what we have to do is we have to do the Fourier transform of the x of t, time domain signal. Then we'll get the frequency domain signal we'll get. So the definition is x of omega is integral minus infinity to infinity x of t e power minus j omega t dt. So forward Fourier transform converts from time domain to frequency domain. So the other thing is inverse. So if you have frequency information, sometimes you need to get the time domain data. For that, what we do is x of t is equal to 1 by 2 pi integral minus infinity to infinity, capital X of omega, that is frequency data, frequency plot, multiplied by e power j omega t d omega. So this is inverse Fourier transform converts from frequency domain to time domain. So this is a synthesis equation, or it's also called design equation. So this fast Fourier transform is developed in 1965 by Cooler 2K. So this this will do the fast Fourier transform, Pooletuke algorithm. We call it as Pooletuke algorithm. It was developed in 1965. So from that we'll get the fast Fourier transform, and we transform time domain signal to a frequency domain signal. So here, similar to that, impulse response function is a time domain function. Frequency response function, FRF, is a frequency domain function. So this is very much useful in model analysis. Used in model analysis for finding the natural frequencies of a system. Whenever we do the model analysis, our intention is to get the natural frequencies of that particular system. If it is 3 degrees of freedom system, we'll get 3 natural frequencies. This can be done by, what we do is that whatever we want to find the natural frequency, we give a small impulse with an impulse hammer. So input what we are giving is impulse response. Output what we are getting is FRF, frequency response function. From this frequency response function, we'll be able to tell the natural frequencies of the system. Yes, next. So a quick look at the how time domain data is transformed to frequency domain data. So it is a simple sine wave. So at what frequency it is repeating? So here it is nearly 15,000 RPM. I guess it is Xerxes units is 15,000 RPM. So 15,000, when the machine is running at 15,000 RPM, so the plot, there is nothing else is there, simply pure, like it is possible in electronics applications. So simply sine wave. So here the amplitude is known, sine wave is known, time domain data, but we'll not be in a position to comment about that. What we do the Fourier transform. Fourier transform will give a below picture. What is the frequency, at what frequency that signal is coming? Here in this case, it is 1500 RPM. The amplitude is 0.3947, maybe it is millimeters per second, okay, or displacement, mils. What I mean to say is, this time domain data, if you do the Fourier transform, you will get the frequency domain data. It is simple to understand, that's why I have shown this particular plot. Next, please. Usually, the plot time domain data will not be that simple. Complex sine waves, it consists of complex sine waves, combination of so many frequency components. So this is an spectrum or vibration signature. So it is at different frequencies, it is having peaks. This is a direct drive pump. Running speed is 1800 RPM. So 1800 RPM, we are getting the predominant peak. And 120,000 Fmax at 400 lines of resolution. So spectrum resolution is 300 CPM per line. So that all, whenever we do some instrumentation or experimentation, we need to know all those things. So here, bearing defect frequency harmonics, 30 kilo CPM to 120 kilo CPM. So high frequency bearing defect generally we'll get at high frequencies, but 1x, when it is 1x, it is unbalanced. When it is 2x, it may be looseness, or 3x, sometimes it is misalignment. Okay, so below figure, again, it is belt-driven fan. So motor, it is running at 1785 RPM, fan at 904 RPM, and belts at 588 RPM. This is the vibration signature, the spectrum we are getting. So it is having so many peaks. The predominant peak is at 1770. So belt-driven fan. So that means predominant peak is at 1770. There is something wrong. Maybe we can correlate, or we can say something wrong in the bell-driven fan, because it is matching, the running speed and this predominant peak are matching. We'll be able to make some conclusion with this information. Yes, next, please. So here, this is one important thing I want to emphasize: spectrum interpretation. So whenever you measure the vibrations, of course, time domain data only the instruments or the transducers will be able to capture. Then after capturing the raw data, we do some transformation, that is past Fourier transformation, we get these frequency plots. We talk about the spectrums only or vibration signatures. The first case, it is radial overhang rotors only, axial. It is mostly, it is 1x component, predominant peak we are getting at 1x. This is very, very fundamental and basic thing. If you get a 1x peak, 1x predominant peak in radial direction, that is mostly unbalance is the defect in the machine. Unbalance problem is there. So sometimes it is given in the brackets, overhang rotors. So it is radial direction means generally vibrations we measure in three directions. That is called triaxial measurements we do. Two in radial direction, one in axial direction. Two in radial direction is one is horizontal, one is vertical. This has a lot of importance, whether it is horizontal component or vertical or axial. So here 1x component usually unbalanced will get a radial. When you measure radial vibrations, if you get 1x predominant peak, that is unbalanced problem. So sometimes same 1x peak will get, in case of overhanging rotors, axial vibration also will get the same data, axial vibrations. So the next one is misalignment, radial parallel and our axial angular we have misalignment, radial misalignment will be there and angular misalignment will be there. It is angular misalignment. So that is, again, the spectrum, we are going to get the same spectrum, but in axial direction. If it is angular misalignment, it is axial direction. Radial misalignment, it is parallel, means either horizontal or vertical. So typically for misalignment problem, we get the spectrum like this. We will have 1x, 2x and 3x peaks in the frequency domain data. So other is similar plot we are getting, 1x, 2x, the third one, 1x, 2x, 3x, axial direction, we are getting this kind of data. It can be a problem of torque bearings and bent shaft at bearings. Okay, so this is very important. Both the plots are looking identical. It is very difficult to distinguish between these kind of problems because plots looks identical. Then you need to look into whether this particular plot is we are getting in axial direction or we are getting in radial direction. From that we'll be able to tell, we'll make some conclusions. This next piece. So structural looseness, if some foundation boards or something is loose, in case of structural looseness, this is the first one is the plot we are going to get spectrum or vibration signature. So 1x and 2x generally we'll get in case of looseness. So that is structural looseness, and bearing looseness, the plot will be something like this, 1x, 2x. 2x is predominant, and 3x, 4x, 5x, 6x also we are getting the top middle one. And housing distortion or soft put, it's also called soft put or piping stress, etc. We are getting 1x predominant peak, 1x peak we are getting, and 2 into FL. So in case of motors, electrical machines, line frequency, because electricity, what we are getting is electricity 50 or 60 hertz. At that frequency, we are getting the electricity. So at 50 or 60 hertz, we'll get line frequency, that is 2x line frequency. In case of pumps, that is in case of motors, this 2 into FL is in case of motors, line frequency, two times the line frequency. This is in case of pumps and fans, VPF is vane passing frequency. So this is called vane passing frequency. So if the machine is running at 3000 RPM, so if it is having three vanes, so 3 into 3, 9000 RPM, we may get a peak depending on the problem in the machine that we are in that particular vanes. So we get vane passing frequencies. And the second one, second row, so resonance much higher than the other directions. Here the amplitude is very high. In case of resonance, the amplitude is very high. So the predominant peak will be like this. And another thing is critical speeds. Of course, critical speeds, we have above critical, we are getting some peak. At critical, we are getting the predominant peak. Okay. And then come to belt problems. Belt problems, the radial direction spectrum will be at driven frequencies, belt harmonics driven frequencies, we are getting the peaks and driver frequencies. That means driven means prime mover, driver means driven is load, driver is prime mover. So at those frequencies we will be getting the predominant peaks. In between we have belt harmonics, so belt frequencies we will be getting. So the bottom middle one, again axial direction, if you get a peaks like the two peaks driven and a driver, so that could be a belt problem or pulley alignment problem. And belt problems, eccentric pulley or bent shaft, so radial direction where we'll get a predominant peak like this. These are some of the typical spectrums. This is how generally we need to interpret. Yes, next please. Yeah, some more spectrums interpretation, sleeve bearings, looseness, rubs, oil well. So oil well predominant peaks we'll get at 0.42 to 0.48 RPM. If it is RPM is 1000 RPM, if it is coming at 420 RPM to 480 RPM, then we can suspect in radial direction. That this particular spectrum is in radial direction. So we can suspect oil well. So similarly, rolling element bearings, as high frequency components we'll get in case of bearing defects. So that's what is shown in that particular spectrum. And hydraulic and aerodynamic forces, we'll get the predominant peaks 1x, 2x, and vane passing frequencies, and 2x vane passing frequencies, or sometimes blade passing frequency we call. So this is a typical plot in case of hydraulic and aerodynamic problems. And in pump cavitation or flow turbulence, then the next spectrum, random broadband vibration. So, and below is AC motor problems. In that case, line frequency we will get, as I told you, electrical motors or electrical machines. So sometimes we'll get predominant peak at the electricity frequency, 50 or 60 hertz. Usually electricity frequency is 50 hertz. So again, the last one is AC motor problems, loose rotor bars or windings. Yeah. So it is radial high frequency. So we may have 1x and greater than 40x RPM, and patterns of peaks of 2 into line frequency apart. Okay, different line passing frequencies we are going to get. So this kind of plot we'll get in case of AC motor problems. Next, please. Yeah, this is about DC motor problems, drive problems, and speed fluctuations, gear problems, wear, eccentricity, and backlash. So this is our different, some of the spectrum interpretation, this is how we have to do. That's what I told in the beginning. So with time domain data, we cannot tell all these things. We need to do the Fourier transform of the time domain data to get the frequency domain information. Then these different problems will show these different kinds of spectrums. So this is how we have to interpret. Next, please. So this is one important observation. At low running speeds, we'll see a peak at 1x, first natural frequency. So it is not 1x or 2x, it is first natural frequency, that is resonance condition. Because of unbalanced dominance is less. When unbalanced dominance is less, so we'll get at first natural frequency. We'll get a peak at first natural frequency. Whereas same machine, it is running at higher speeds, higher running speeds, unbalance dominates, and we will see 1x peak predominantly. Peak at national frequency disappears. This is one important observation one can know about. So at low speeds, for the same machine, everything is same. When the machine is running at low speeds, we'll get a peak at first natural frequency. And when the machine picks up and it reaches to its maximum speed, this particular peak disappears and we'll get 1x predominant peak we'll get. Next, please. Next, please. Yeah, this is, yeah, all this interpretation, spectrum interpretation. So you need to practice. If you are not, somebody else is. This is a caption. I want to have it in between after this. What I mean to say is we need to study a lot of spectrums, different spectrums. We need to understand different, how different spectrums are there and how to interpret what is the problem. Yes, next, please. Yeah, all these things we have seen, and common bearing numbering conventions. Whenever you do some conclusions, whenever you do some condition modeling, so these are, we have to this is the convention, bearing numbering convention. We have to number like this, bearing one. So motor, that is a prime mover, is the motor, and load is a fan or blower, whatever it is, blower it seems. Okay, motor, non-drive end bearing of the motor or prime mover is bearing one, drive end of the bearing is bearing two, and drive end of the load is bearing three, non-driving end of the load is bearing four. These are, we have to do the numbering, especially for making vibration measurements and to interpret the things. So these things also one should know. Yes, next, please. So this same bearing numbering convention in case of gear problems. So what about components that have more than two bearings, such as gear boxes? The image at right, which does not show the motor containing bearings one and two, we are not in this particular figure. Motor part is removed, motor part is not there. Of course, that is like previous one only, one and two, non-drive end is one, drive end bearing is two, that numbering is as usual. Shows a typical numbering convention for components with more than two bearings. Again, it is based on following the drivetrain in a logical manner. The important thing is to set up a simple straightforward convention and adhere to it consistently. You can use other people's ideas and conventions or develop your own. Develop one yourself that makes sense to your people for your mission. Of course, some flexibility is there based on your experience and other things. So we can have numbering. So the gearbox shown here is a double reduction gearbox. Here it is a double reduction gearbox. Simply, most of the times we have single reduction gearbox. Here it is a double reduction gearbox. This gearbox has three shaft speeds. The input shaft speed, this is the input shaft. So, and the speed of the shaft supported by bearings 5 and 6, the intermediate shaft, this is intermediate shaft, 5 and 6 numbering. And the output shaft speed and two gear mesh frequencies. Here, these two gears are meshing. Here, this is bevel gears, these two gears are meshing. So here we'll get gear meshing frequency 1 and gear meshing frequency 2. In case of double reduction, gear meshing frequencies, there is a possibility that we get two gear meshing frequencies. And next, please. So common direction naming conventions. Axial direction is always parallel to the shaft axis. So as I told you, triaxial, generally whenever we do vibration measurements, we do triaxial measurements, one in axial direction and two in radial direction. The radial direction is horizontal and vertical is the radial directions. So generally these triaxial measurements we'll be doing. Yes, next, please. So quickly we look to the transducers. Generally, as I told you, whenever we measure vibrations, we measure whether it is displacement, velocity, or acceleration. So quickly have a look at these accelerometers. Accelerometers work on the principle of piezoelectric principle. And velocity probes, moving coil velocity transducer, are used. So springs and magnets. And sometimes we use seismic probes for this velocity measurement. And this displacement probe is, it is a proximity probe. This is non-contact one. Displacement probe is a non-contact one, proximity probe. Other two are contact. So you have to have a contact to measure velocity or accelerometer. Whereas for measuring displacement, contact will not be there. Non-contact probe. So depending on the air gap, the displacement probe or proximity probe is fixed like this at the shaft or at a vibrating pot. Depending on the vibration or the air gap aeration between the vibrating pot and the displacement probe, it measures the displacements. Next, please. So this is a typical plot. So displacement probe, it measures from, what I mean to say is from this plot, for low frequency applications, we use displacement probes. And for general purpose machines, we use velocity probes, medium. For high frequency applications, we use accelerometers. Okay, so the displacement probes, it can measure 300 CPM to cycles per minute to 1800 cycles per minute. And accelerometers are used for measuring 60,000 RPM CPM to 180,000 CPM. And for general purpose machines, these velocity probes are used. It can be used for 400 CPM to approximately 140,000 CPM. If it is more than that, we must go for accelerometers. And if it is less than 300, we have to go for displacement probe. Notice that at low frequencies, primarily below 300 CPM or 5 Hz, displacement is the most sensitive unit to the likelihood of a failure. That is due to the fact that a stress failure, something being bent back and forth until it breaks, is the most likely failure mode at those low frequencies. The phatic and applied forces become, as frequency approaches zero, simply too low to cause a failure. And once you get above 300 CPM, the most likely failure mode is increasingly becomes the phatic mode, to which velocity is the most sensitive unit. Next one. Yeah, too quickly, we'll look into this. How much time?
2 minutes.
Yeah, quickly, we'll go through these things. So basic elements of mathematical aspects when we look into, because all these things we are studying, condition monitoring we are doing by using vibration and also by measuring vibration levels. Other methods are also there, but we don't bother. I'm not into that particular aspects. So basic elements of a vibratory system are spring mass, inertial element, restoring elements. Inertial element is nothing but mass. Restoring element is stiffness, that is spring. And damping element dashpot will be there. Of course, here it is not there. So in free vibrations, our main intention or aim is to find the natural frequency. So this particular spring mass system is a single degree of freedom system. So equilibrium method, it is in dynamic equilibrium. Draw the free body diagram, write the equilibrium equations, considering inertia effect. And if you develop the governing equation, that governing equation is similar to the simple harmonic motion equation. So from the similarity, if you compare omega n is, we'll get it as root k by m. In single degree of freedom systems, the natural frequency is, angular natural frequency is square root of root k by m. Yeah. So stiffness by mass, if you square root it, you get the natural frequency. 2 pi by t. So R otherwise linear frequency if you want in hertz. Omega n is in radians per second. Fn is in cycles per second. Hertz. So that is 1 by T. 2 pi will not be there in this case. Of course, you know that. So next one is energy method. So in the energy method, the total mechanical energy is constant. So if you differentiate a constant, you will get zero. That's what we are doing here. So kinetic energy and potential energy of a particular vibrating system will measure. And we do this. This is called energy method. And we have another method, Rayleigh's method. The maximum kinetic energy at mean position is equal to the maximum potential energy at the extreme positions. Why these methods, different methods, means depending on the engineering application and depending on the system, sometimes it is convenient to draw the free body diagram. But in some situations, it is difficult to draw the free body diagram, but we are able to find kinetic energy and potential energy. Sometimes even that is not possible, we'll be able to measure maximum kinetic energy and maximum potential energy only. Depending on the problem, or depending on the data which we are accessible and we get the information, this any one of these methods we use to get the natural frequency of the single equilibrium system. Next, please. So this is again damper. Damper is there. Earlier case, damping is not there. So if you draw the free body diagram, K into delta plus X, CX dot, and MG. So yeah, KX and CX is there, and inertia force is there, of course. Inertia is not shown here. So here, yeah, we should be careful. So this is static equilibrium position. So in static equilibrium, the spring will the system will deflect through X. Okay. So before that, the static equilibrium, this delta will be there, static deflection. So here in vibration problems, we don't consider this MG. Very often students are going to confuse. MG and static deflection force K delta will get cancelled. So this is again the same thing, spring, damper and mass, excitation force. This is damped vibrations, this is forced vibrations. In both the cases, K delta and MG will get canceled, and we don't show those forces on the free body diagrams. So the governing equation in case of damped vibrations, what we are going to get is X double dot plus C by MX dot plus K by MX equal to zero. Or otherwise, if you don't divide it by M, MX double dot plus CX dot plus KX equal to zero, generally we'll write. So the solution of this particular, this is a, the governing equation is a second order differential equation. So this second order differential equation, we need to find the solution or response. Generally, for this kind of damped vibratory system, the response will be X is equal to A e power alpha 1 t plus B e power alpha 2 t. So where alpha 1, alpha 2 are the roots of the auxiliary equation, alpha square plus C by M alpha plus K by M equal to 0. So here, from this equation, from if you take this ratio, square root of C by 2M square by K by M, this is this particular ratio, this factor, we define it as damping factor or damping ratio. Here C is, damper C is there. The C is damping coefficient. Here zeta is damping factor. C or zeta, it shows the amount of damping present in the system. Sometimes there is a relationship, it is both are related. Zeta is equal to C by 2 root Km. C is damping coefficient, zeta is damping factor. Next, please. So when zeta is equal to 1, the damping is known as critical. And C is denoted by CC. Critical damping, C is denoted by CC, critical damping coefficient. From that, the definition becomes, damping factor becomes C by CC. So the actual damping coefficient, the ratio of actual damping coefficient to the critical damping coefficient, So here we different cases arise, zeta equal to 1, zeta is greater than 1. This zeta equal to 1, it is critical damping. Zeta is greater than 1, the system is overdamped. And zeta is less than 1, the system is underdamped. That means in first two cases, critical damping and overdamping, vibrations will not be there, sine term will not be there. Whereas in third case, when zeta is less than 1, so when zeta is less than 1, the roots are complex, we will get the complex roots. Once you say when complex roots are there, there are some oscillations are possible. Okay? Only in third case, underdamped case, the roots are complex. When zeta is less than 1, the roots are complex. So zeta square minus 1 becomes negative, square root of negative value, will get complex roots. That's why I we have taken out and it is written 1 minus zeta square. Here we define a term called omega d, damped natural frequency, that is equal to omega n into square root of 1 minus zeta square. So in this case, underdamped case, the governing equation is mx double dot plus cx dot plus kx equal to 0. In this case, the solution, final solution, what we are going to get is x is equal to x e power minus zeta omega nt sine omega dt plus phi. Here, these three things are there in the solution. Capital X, small x is equal to capital X. Capital X is maximum amplitude of vibration in that particular underdamped case. So this is second term is negative exponential e power minus zeta omega nt. If you plot this negative exponential, as the time increases, the amplitude x will decrease. Okay, maximum amplitude, and this negative exponential tells the decay in the amplitude of the vibration, and this sine term indicates there are some oscillations up there. These three things one should understand in case of underdamped vibrations. Sine term indicates oscillations in the system. Of course, it will decay with time. As time reaches sufficiently large value and almost equal to zero, amplitude becomes almost equal to zero. So, of course, this capital X and phi, the constant capital X and phi are we determined from the initial conditions. So here, of course, I hope you know all these things. Logarithmic decrement will define. It is natural logarithm of ratio of successive amplitudes. And upon simplification, if you logarithmic decrement, if you want to write in terms of zeta, upon simplification, you will get it as 2 by zeta by square root of 1 minus zeta square. Next, please. Here, response, if you see the underdamped case, response will be like this, maximum amplitude of vibration. Here, TD is damped time period. In case of damping only, this amplitude will decay over a period of time. So as the T reaches sufficiently large time, it becomes almost zero. So this bottom plot is the figure is the different damping factors. Zeta equal to zero, when there is no damping in the system, it is simply a sine wave. And zeta is less than one, under damped. Zeta is equal to one, critically damped. Zeta is greater than one, it is overdamped. In case of overdamping, the response will be like this. In case of critically damping, the response will be like this. That means in both the cases, the motion is aperiodic. There is no vibration in the system. And in underdamped case and there is no damping, free vibrations, response is there. Free vibrations, the amplitude is constant. In damped vibrations, amplitude is decaying as the time increases. Next. Of course, next, this is post vibrations. Next, please. Yeah, again, this K delta and Mg, we need not consider in case of vibrations. Both are equal and will get cancelled. Static deflection and weight of the body. So this is the free body diagram. This is the governing equation. Mx double dot plus cx dot plus kx is equal to f naught sine omega t. So this particular, in this case, we have three omegas. Omega and natural frequency. Omega d damped natural frequency. Omega is, f naught is magnitude of the force, which is acting, upright force. And omega is the frequency of the excitation force. This is governing equation of proposed vibration. Next, please. Yeah, generally we write F equal to MA. When you talk about D'Alembert's principle, we generally write F equal to MA, but that's not correct. MA is equal to F, we have to write, or A is equal to F by M. So this is the cause-effect relationship. The cause is independent variable, F is the cause, A is the effect. This F is independent variable, A is dependent variable. Yes, next please. Again, when you talk about forced vibrations, as we discussed, this is the governing equation in case of forced vibrations. This is, again, it is a second order differential equation. This is, we see, non-homogeneous equation. When right hand side is not zero, when there is a right hand term, this is non-homogeneous equation. This non-homogeneous second order differential equation, the solution will be of the form x is, it contains two parts, complementary function and particular integral. Complementary function is nothing but when you equate right hand side to zero and if you find the solution, that is a complementary function. Okay, so the complementary function already we have seen that we'll get in case of damped, underdamped vibrations. So this x e power minus zeta omega t sine omega dt plus pi is the CF. And this is the particular integral. Of course, I hope you know how to get the particular integral. It comes like this. Here we define a term called beta. Beta is omega by ratio of frequencies. We call it as beta. So this is the total solution of the forced vibratory system. Next, please. So, amplitude of steady state response, A is amplitude of steady state response. So, F0 by K is static diffraction. Here, we define a term called magnification factor, that is ratio of amplitude of steady state vibration to the static diffraction. Upon simplification, we'll get like 1 by square root of 1 minus beta square root square plus 2 zeta beta square, where beta is the ratio of frequencies, omega by omega n, excitation frequency and natural frequency. Here we define this magnification factor is the ratio of steady state amplitude to the static diffraction. That's what is this, upon simplification, we'll get this magnification factor. Next. And here we define, in case of forced vibrations, we define one more term called transmissibility, epsilon. F of t, this is nothing but ratio of f of t by f naught. F of t is force transmitted to the foundation to the applied force, excitation force. Upon simplification in terms of zeta and beta, we'll get the expression equation like this. Next, please. Yeah, so transmissibility versus ratio of frequencies, if you plot it. So this one is, what is one? One is nothing but resonance condition. When excitation frequency is equal to the natural frequency of the system, so the excitation is almost infinity. Again, in this plot, if you observe it, so this is amplification part and this is isolation part. Root 2 is the one important thing we have to keep in mind. If the machines are running below the ratio of frequencies value root 2, then in that case, damping is useful. But once, if the machines are running beyond this value, ratio of frequencies value greater than root 2, and damping is of no use. As you go on, increase the damping, the transmitted force is increasing. Transmissibility is nothing but applied force is constant. We can correlate it with the force transmitted to the foundation. So here, as the damping is increasing, carefully observe, if the damping is increasing, the force transmitted is increasing. Next, please. So these are some equivalent models. As we are running short of time, this you can go through. As next, please. This is simply supported beam. This can be modeled if it is vibration model. If you want to model it as a vibration model, you can model it as a spring mass system. The stiffness is simply from strength of materials. We know stiffness is 48 EI by L cube. So it can be modeled like this. Next, 2 degrees of freedom systems. So many 2 degrees of freedom systems we'll come across. is a fixed field system and it is a double pendulum. Next. Fixed field systems, free field systems, and fixed systems. So this free field system is also called semi-definite system. So here number of natural frequencies is equal to number of degrees of freedom. This we can skip. Next. Here common procedure to solve the time length. Common procedure to solve the 2 degrees of freedom systems. Free wire diagram, forces acting on each MOS. So first step is you need to draw the free wire diagram of each MOS. Then governing equation, equilibrium equations will give you the governing equation. In case of dynamics, we call it as differential equation of motion. So then assume simple harmonic solution. This is differential equation of motion is a second order differential equation. So assume simple harmonic solution and substitute in the governing differential equation, thus converting to the algebraic equation. So simple harmonic solution means x is equal to a sine omega t. Wherever x is there, x dot, x double dot, you find out that is we substitute in this equation. This differential equation is converted to the algebraic equation. Once it is converted to the simultaneous algebraic equations, solve the simultaneous algebraic equation to obtain the eigenvalues from which the natural frequencies can be obtained. Eigenvalue is generally denoted by lambda, is square of the natural frequency. Eigenvector is mode shape. Compute the mode shape and draw the mode shape. Mode shape is how different masses of this. Mode shape is nothing but how different masses of the vibrating system are moving relative to each other. So we need to know the mode shape, draw the mode shape. Next. Yeah, quickly, if you look into this, there is a lot of scope in this condition monitoring to use artificial intelligence. So this is one of the technique, artificial intelligence generally we use by neural technique, neural networks. So this is the simple computational model of a neuron. Two basic problems generally we can come across this condition monitoring problem, so classification problem and biggest problem. Next. Artificial neural networks offer advantages for automatic detection and diagnostic of rotating machines. Yeah, next, I think same slide repeated. Next. Okay, animation is there. The basic building block for an artificial neural network is neuron. Next. Yes, next. Yeah, this is a confusion matrix we'll get like this when you model it as a classification problem. Generally, this confusion matrix will get in classification problems. Here, it is a four-class problem. Four different classes are there. So that's why we get 4x4 matrix. Of course, this is additional information we'll get. So this is output class and this is target class. So the confusion matrix, statistical features in horizontal direction. So this particular confusion matrix is 80% accurate. Next, this is how to calculate those things are different calculation procedure is there. That we'll see whenever some opportunity comes next time. Yes, next. So classification is done with 80% accuracy. Only first class 9 out of 20 samples classified properly. Class 2 is done with 100% accuracy. Class 3 with 90% accuracy. Class 4 with 85% accuracy. Next. So that is horizontal direction. This is vertical direction. Vertical direction, so the classification is done with 92.4% accuracy. In horizontal direction, it is a bit less. So that means vertical vibration data is, in this particular case, it is vertical vibration data is used more accurate. So next. Of course, this is not required. So this is what I want to discuss. So this is some experimental setup. Next. So how strain measurements are done by using slip rings? Of course, nowadays nobody is using the slip rings. Just I want to show you how strains are measured in rotating parts. Earlier we used to have slip rings and we used to measure strains. Next. So this is telemetry. So now telemetric non-contact systems are available to measure the strains in the rotating machines, rotors. So why I'm showing this one is, so if a fatty crack is there in the crack, sorry, rotor, if a fatty crack is there in the rotor and also some misalignment is there, so if you do the vibration analysis, you will get the same plot, the same FFT plot you will get, spectrum you will get. It is very difficult to distinguish between crack and misalignment. So what we did is, so we have done experiments with strain measurements and misalignment measurements. So and it is observed that strain is insensitive to the misalignment. If this misalignment is the problem is there, strain is insensitive, whereas crack is insensitive to the vibration problems. So this is one very important observation we made. Okay. Anyway, I want to show you how the strain measurements are done in rotors. The first one is by using slip rings in olden days. Now telemetry strain gauge system is available, non-contact. We can measure strains like this. Next. Here, this is a presumed figure, damage location in telemetry strain gauge assembly. Yes, next. Yeah, this is what I want to share with you. Thank you. And if you have any queries, you feel free to ask any queries related to this particular vibrations or condition monitoring. Thank you.